crashing Willie's garage.
Ha! Well, hello, Rhonda.
Hello, Rhondas.
It's the ALF show. It's Willie's Garage. I'm Nick. I am a lifelong ALF fan. George is reluctantly watching ALF for the first time, and he's back for 10 episodes. We've been doing 10 of these, George.
It only feels like 8.
Well, that's the thing. We were talking about, you know, in doing this rewatch of ALF, I'm struck by, you know, we put some work into this, pulling clips, watching the episode, pulling ALF merchandise. There's work that goes into the show. And we're 10 episodes in, and it feels like work sometimes. And there's been 22 episodes in the first season. So that's a lot more work to write and produce and get the puppet and, you know. So 22 episodes in a season just seems insane to me. I don't know how they did it back in 1986.
Well, it does seem to be that there's a relationship between the number of episodes per season, perhaps, and the quality. Like, if you watch a Netflix show has, what, 8 to 10 episodes,
yeah,
and they're all cliffhangers, you know?
Right. Yeah, so that means in a general season, we'll probably get 10 good ones, maybe 12 good ones. I've watched ahead. There's some great ones coming up. This one is, it's okay. It's okay. But before we get to that, it's ALFsgiving. I wanted to be the first to wish you and your family a happy ALFsgiving.
And to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I wanted to talk about 1989's Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, because ALF was one of the co-hosts with Willard Scott. Some kind soul on YouTube put the whole, just the ALF highlights. And then I cut those down into even further highlights. So here's a little bit of ALF at the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade.
We have a special visitor, ALF, that mischievous ambassador from outer space. As we look ahead in our parade.
Hey, I'll do the looking ahead if you don't mind. Now I could see singer Judy Kay and,
My turn now. Coming soon, Scott Bakula with the NCAA Superstar Dance Team, the Rangerettes, and Cabal. Stick around.
Or is she pushing?
Do you think people are excited to see Big Bird or what?
Tom Lewis!
Country singer Cliff. It's a little bit of a technical.
And the biggest turkey you ever saw, next to Ishtar. Yum, yum!
Timeless joke. Timeless joke. Probably didn't have all the A writers doing the Macy's writing for him, but...
I love the holiday parade directing, where...
Yes.
Where I don't know what the expectation is exactly. Like, is it supposed to be from the eyes of the person in the crowd?
Yeah, I don't
know. Pre-recorded parts where they're trying to keep in sync. It's rough.
There's definitely some miscommunication with the earpiece. And then, you know, as a puppeteer, you can't – generally, you're looking at a monitor to see what you look like. But I don't know how you would have done that here. So and he's in a window of Macy's. Here's a little bit more.
Hey, Miss America 1990 Debbie Turner sings about love. The nitty gritty dirt band plays. The Joker is wild when our parade marches on.
That would have been Batman Joker, right?
Yeah.
Because this would have been 1990, so it was the year after Batman, right?
Right.
Hey, the music, the clowns, and the floats will continue with Jill Schultz and the Peanuts gang skating on ice. And when we come back, one of my favorite things, the giant pink panther balloon.
Yeah.
Someone get me a fork. Love that cat. Yum, yum. But I gotta tell you, here's the fat cat that I've been waiting for. Garfield the Delicious. Now this is the sixth time this tabby has stalked down Broadway in Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. And if my plans work out, it'll be his last.
Okay, Santa Claus, God bless, Merry Christmas.
Talk about weird directing. Look at how, like, ALF's in the middle, Willard's kind of dipping into him.
May I, please? And ALF, are you in there, old boy?
I certainly am, Willard.
Hey, give me a kiss, ALF.
Can I help you,
ALF?
Great.
All right. We're having alien for Thanksgiving at our house. Come on,
what?
Wow, there's the... You know that there was a kid trying to explain to his grandmother. Well, thousands of them. Well, he eats cats, Grandma. What? Yeah. Why?
Yeah.
You know.
That was the source of all the jokes. And I do remember watching that Macy's Parade. Anything that ALF was on, I would tune into. And a kind soul just sent me all of ALF's Hollywood Squares appearances. And and I was told that anytime ALF would appear on Hollywood Squares, he would be the center square, and the ratings would like double. So I was not the only one tuning in just to watch ALF on Hollywood Squares.
Unless the ratings went from one to two people.
Yeah, exactly.
Then it would double.
Right. I don't know how many people. I have a lot of memories of Hollywood Squares. Did you watch that show, George, at all?
Not as much as you.
Okay. All right. Well, let's get into a Mel Mac recap. Episode 10 aired on December 1st, 1986. It's called Baby, You Can Drive My Car, Beatles song. This episode didn't make any sense to me, George. Were you able to parse out what happens?
I think so. I mean, I think there's a lot of this episode was strange. I felt like weirdly, it seemed like, is there a chance that these were filmed out of order? Because Brian seemed younger in some of these.
Yeah, I bet.
Than in other ones.
Yeah, I bet the network decided later where they're going to go. The basic plot is Lynn's trying to go see the Pretenders in concert, and the Tanners only have one car. Willie and Kate are getting back from something. The car gets towed, so she misses the concert. And so they decide to allow Lynn to get a job so that she can work up enough money to get a car. And she gets a job at a place called the Chicken and Oyster, Uncle Jim's, I think it's called. Mr. Jim's Chicken and Oysters.
Why is that? I guess I didn't know why that was funny. Is it because the idea that they have two very different items, like cuisines that are being served?
I think it's like a comedy writer thing. That's just like, you know, it's kind of like in The Simpsons where they had nuts and gum. Like those things don't go together.
I guess because I went to Long John Silver's growing up, that it would be like anything that you can fried, anything that can be fried can be served on a plate. So I guess it.
Yeah. Well, that's, I guess, where Lynn's working. She gets back from her first day of work and has brought some food for the Tanners. ALF is not in the scene, but it's weird.
Here you are, sir. The pullet and gullet platter. Chicken on the half shell for the lady.
Thank you.
An oyster dog and a Mr. Jim's game card for you.
What do I do?
You scratch off.
I want that hat so bad. Just a big foam red flat brimmed hat that says Mr. Jim's on it.
Three oysters and win a pack of cigarettes.
Which is the chicken and which is the oyster then?
This tastes like fish.
Then that's the chicken. I'm gonna go change.
I won! Menthol lights!
I didn't mind that joke. You get a free pack of cigarettes.
There's a weird bunch of weird combinations of jokes in this. There are some that seem like it was just for the writer and his friends, then there are some that are just 80s sitcom jokes.
There's a lot of that because, well, we'll get into it later. But there's like a sleazy like car dealer type character like that is just mentioned off screen, and he talks about going to the Springs, meaning Palm Springs, which is such a, like an LA. Observational thing that I felt like it had to be some observation about somebody that on the writing staff knew. So right. Also in this, I think in the cold open, ALF finds out that gold is worth something on Earth. He's watching a show. He finds out that gold's valuable, but on Melmac, it's worthless. And all the stuff that's on Melmac, like lint and foam, that stuff's not worth anything here on Earth. And so instead of making Lynn wait to save up enough money to get the car, he hawks all the gold from the wiring in his spaceship and buys her a brand new Ferrari. Here's a clip of ALF in the Ferrari. And this may have been the first time, I think, that I saw a car phone on anything.
ALF, pull off the road. Pull the car off the road.
I can't. I'm in the fast lane, although you'd never know it by the way these clowns are driving. Come on.
This would make a great GIF, wouldn't it? Just like, I mean, I would want to send this to somebody.
But by the way these clowns are driving. Come on, lady! This ain't a parade!
Alfred, don't yell at the other drivers. They'll see you.
No way! I'm driving too fast. Hey, ever hear of a turn signal?
Just look, Alf, listen to me. Look at the road signs. Try to find out. Look at exactly where you are.
Well, I just passed the Motel 6. Hey, they're having a beekeeper's convention. Ouch! Ow! Ow! Ow!
Another, like, weird, wacky joke. Like, you know, a Motel 6, as if it wasn't weird enough, they piled on other weird stuff like that.
Right, and there was the there was that it had a Gucci airbag.
Yes.
That the person he sold the gold to also invested in an Oxnard mango farm. There were there were several of these that really stuck out, especially in light of the previous 9 episodes.
It felt like almost like a Mad Lib style of comedy, where it's like, you know, you're like mango farm, Oxnard, you know, and then that's what you ended up with. And he's on the car phone. Alf, they're looking for him. They're trying to find out what Motel 6 is. And then they hear a crash. And Alf has crashed into the namesake of this very program, Willie's Garage.
Well, I'll call Joel tomorrow. I'll sell the car. And we'll use the money to fix the garage.
You'll do that? You'll call Joel?
Well, actually, it'll be Joel's assistant. Because, as I have mentioned, Joel is in the Springs.
That sounds fair, doesn't it, Willie?
I suppose so. I suppose it does, Alf. I'm glad you weren't hurt.
Thanks. Of course, I'll want a complete physical before I sign anything. Just kidding.
I don't understand. This is the plot, part of the plot I don't understand. He's totaled the car. It's wrecked not only the garage, but the car. How is he going to sell it back to the guy who bought the gold? Like, the car's, you know, worth very little at this point.
This isn't the sort of like plot hole that we're only seeing in retrospect. This is something that
a huge plot hole.
While writing it, should have come up, and then every day for the last 33 years, somebody should have been asking this.
Well, what I'm finding is that Alf, a lot of episodes, Alf gets himself into a jam, and just they don't bother figuring out a way to have him get out in any logical way. You know, some episodes he does, but this one I think they just kind of hand waved it. Like, he sells it back to the guy. You know,
it's cartoon. This is a very cartoony episode, and that's where the Oxnard mango farm really fits in. I mean, this could all be like a if the whole show was turned into a Sunday comic strip, I think it would work almost exactly as it is, where, you know, you can just have a word balloon and you don't need any further explanation.
Yeah. Just sweep it under the rug. I you know, this was another episode where I just feel like they thought of what they could promote. And there are a lot of episodes like Full House. There was one where I think DJ crashes the car into the garage. And this is another one where if you showed that on a promo, then a new Alf, you know, and you see him in the car, on the car phone, and then you see him crash, you know, and there's action. They're out of the living room. It's fun to, you know, I got to tune in for that episode.
That was a really good impersonation of the guy who did the NBC promos. I've never heard anybody even attempt that before. This episode had some of the best classic exasperated Willie of any so far, I think.
You're right. His blood boils, he stammers, and he gets pissed when the car gets totaled.
Yes, and I feel like we need to put into perspective what the Ferrari was in the 80s. So I cut together, I put a bunch of pictures together for shows. The Ferrari was like a symbol of masculinity, of conspicuous consumption.
There were posters of just Ferraris that you could have up on your wall.
So Tom Selleck drove one on Magnum PI. There was a white, was it a Testarossa? Was that what they were called?
I think so.
On Miami Vice. If it's something different than that, I don't know what it is. So not technically an error. Yeah.
Neither of us are car guys.
In Cannonball Run, Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. were dressed as priests. I'm not sure if they actually were. I haven't seen the movie. But they drove a Ferrari. Then, of course, in National Lampoon's Vacation, Christie Brinkley was the girl in the Ferrari. And probably the best known one, although not the Ferrari that we're used to seeing from the 80s, was in Ferris Bueller. But again, it was just the sort of symbol of like, I can do whatever I want.
Yeah.
I have reached some sort of pinnacle of greed or whatever.
You know what? Yeah, you're right. And I feel like if there's ever like a teenage boy's bedroom in the 80s, it would have a poster of a Ferrari in it. It was just the ultimate symbol. So it makes sense for ALF, an iconic 80s show, to have that as the centerpiece of the show. Do you think they got paid from Ferrari for that product placement?
Hard to say. I don't know whether it was the sort of like thing where they got loaner use of the car, maybe.
Yeah.
On those things.
Right. Yeah, it was a trade thing.
Yeah. And they certainly couldn't have gotten better publicity than being on Miami Vice. I mean, there must have been many a midlife crisis purchase based strictly on that.
Well, this show is my midlife crisis, so let's get to some ALF crap, shall we?
Sure. Ba-da-dum, da-dum, da-dum,
da-dum, ALF crap. Why don't you start off? What do you have for us, George?
Well, so here is the ALF pencil topper. Ooh. Now, there were so many different types of these from what I found. I'm a people alien. This one, which is be there or be square. I guess when I was looking at these, I was thinking like, how many do you have to sell to make money on these?
What are the margins on pencil toppers?
And I did find that you can actually purchase, this is a blurry photo of it, but you can buy an entire
a bouquet, a
set of 60 of them in their original container. Ooh. for $99 on eBay. And they're of two types, the I'm a people alien and hey, no problem.
Wow.
Yeah.
Those would be good little party favors. Well, I'll consider it. It seems a little overpriced, but not too bad. I mean, those are pretty cool pencil toppers. So we haven't talked about this, but ALF had two cartoons. He had the animated series and then one called ALF Tales, where ALF was involved in 1990, was involved in recreating fairy tales. And the co-creator of that is going to be on the show in 2 weeks. But Bob Hedges found these. These were Wendy's, whatever their equivalent of a Happy Meal was, toys. So they're just rubber figurines. There's a little Elf Riding Hood. There's the wolf. This is, I don't know, what fairy tale is this? Maybe the Knights of the Round Table, Sir Arthur, King Arthur.
What's he stepping on?
An alligator? I don't know if that's canon. And then this is, what do you think this one is? He's kind of a, oh, is this maybe the, I don't know what this would have been.
Is that Mario?
It looks like it. He's got a brick and he's paving a brick.
Oh, maybe the Three Little Pigs?
Three Little Pigs, yeah. And then the last one is, I don't know if this is maybe Romeo and Juliet.
Yeah.
He's kind of dressed in.
Does he have it, or Cyrano de Bergerac? Does he have flowers behind his back?
Yeah, it's Cyrano because of his nose. That's why. But pretty cool little solid toys. These are in great shape. So thanks to Bob Hedges, our viewer, for sending those in. What do you have?
Well, this is pretty amazing. This is
God.
The bumper sticker standee that you would find at stores in 1986, 87 that had six different bumper stickers that you could select. So this is now on eBay for $400.
Oh my God.
It's the counter display with a cardboard backing with 87 original bumper stickers.
I guess you could try to flip that somehow.
Well, I guess so. You can see that the holders have gotten, you know, how old plastic gets kind of yellowed. But I think between this and the pencil toppers, this is the perfect for the impulse buy section of your ALF store.
That's a good idea, right? Because this is all the stuff you're checking out at the dime store in your hometown, and you see this, you see a pencil topper, I'll take one of each.
And I think it's, so you can, they don't have the same number of each of the bumper stickers. And my guess is this was originally from the store, and you can, they list the exact numbers that are left, but the one that sold the most, I believe, is If You're Rich, I'm Single.
It does look like that has the fewest left.
And the second one is My Other Car is a Spaceship.
I think Party Alien would probably get you pulled over. So that's probably why that wasn't that big. I want to show, so we talked, I think last week you talked about the ALF comic books. I've showed a little bit of some of my ALF comics. This one I don't have, but it's one of the more expensive items I've seen for ALF memorabilia. This is an ALF comic for $200, controversial risque seal cover, first print. So I'll just zoom in and show you. Do not buy of safety seals mission, so hurry up already. I don't know. I get it, but I think you got to read into a lot to say that that's risque. It's not like this was pulled off the shelves for indecency.
I'm going to say that the thing that's most disturbing is the I don't know. I might. It's the expression on the seal.
Yeah, I agree. That's the thing that sells it because it's clearly in terror. It's not consenting to whatever ALF is doing to it. So.
Right.
But that wasn't the main thing I wanted to show. The main thing I want to show you is ceramic ALFs. So I have a couple ceramic ALFs, and I guess these were homemade. They came from a few different models of them. This one is extremely rare, they say. This is ALF sitting alien UFO TV show, $350, and it's not painted very well. You can see that it's got they painted kind of a Homer Simpson muzzle on him. And the hair is the most disturbing. Look at the back of the hair. Isn't that awful?
Nightmarish. I mean, maybe if they found this in like an Inca temple, this could be. They don't say that it's of recent vintage.
That's true. It could have been some sort of ancient Egyptian statue.
Yeah.
Where the feet look a little weird. Here's another one I found. Just kind of a short, fat ALF, almost like a Buddha ALF with beautiful eyelashes.
Lovely.
This one, I don't know what the expression is. It's just kind of, you know, almost one hand behind the back bowing. But not too bad. And then this is the weirdest statue. They put real hair on a ceramic statue, gave him a tie, and then did a realistically molded cat, but probably too small, scale wise, in ALF's left hand.
I guess my question is, do you have room for all of these in your apartment?
That's my question, too. If I could somehow, I mean, if I was an eccentric millionaire, I would have all these, but I have to pick and choose. So.
But as an eccentric thousandaire, is it a question of money or is it a question of space?
I'll make space, as I've proven. So, yeah, it's more of the money situation now, but never say never. By the way, quick update. Last week, we talked about the ALF He-Man Masters of the Universe custom figures. I ordered one. $65. I couldn't resist. So maybe in a few weeks, I'll show you my custom made ALF He-Man figure.
So the Patreon to help keep Nick from living in his car, because yep. Then he'd have to get a bigger car for all the ALF stuff.
Yep. Yep. A lot of poor financial decisions happening right now. So join that Patreon right now and help us out. What do you have? You usually have an ALF tattoo to end with.
Yes. This is one that I feel weird about. Weird about because I guess I don't totally understand tattoos in general. Uh-huh. But one is, this is something that, well, first of all, I don't understand why the hands are
blurred out.
Pixelated.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's weird.
You think, I don't know.
It's a low-res photo, but the,
well,
tattoos,
no,
the tattoos, yeah.
This is specifically not to identify somebody. but I don't know, like, is that, I don't understand, I guess that seems to be something that would only be seen by other people at the gym and maybe people in the throes of passion.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure who the, like how that fits into either.
I mean, if I saw that in throes of passion, I'd be thrilled, but I'm a rare case. I think I'm one of the unusual ones. So yeah, that is a questionable. Yeah, it's questionable. I'll agree with that, but I'm just glad we won't be able to identify this woman in the mint green sweatshirt.
I've been staring at people's hands for months now, trying to find them, especially the wrists, because that's the part that's most pixelated.
If you're out there, email us. It's right on your screen right now. Let us know.
The graphic is fine. It's the placement. I don't get it.
Yeah, but I don't.
That's
I don't
just
either.
Me.
The last thing I want to show is one of my pride and joys. This is the ALF phone. Mm-hmm. Look at this thing. This is a well done. I think it's a well done ALF. This is, you know, it's got the eyebrows. There it says ALF phone. No, this was new and I got it. And I'm tempted to plug this in because, you know, I don't have a phone line anymore, but I would really, I just imagine getting a call like about a job or a serious call, like there's a death in the family and you have to answer it on this. I just want to have that story to tell. So I love the ALF phone. I did plug it in at the store where I got it. I got it at a store in the East Village that I just couldn't say no to. And they had one behind the counter that worked. They still had it plugged in and were using it as their official office phone. So,
well, I have noticed that the Rejuvenique face mask has the same sort of socket and
it
plug.
Does. I happen to have that actually because we're doing a college show later, and this you can see we use this at a prop for our found footage festival college shows. So yeah, you're right. That's the same thing. Hmm. Uses this phone cord to electrocute your face. This is a beauty device that we have the instructional video for.
Wow.
Were you amazed that I actually had that right within an arm's reach?
I just think nobody watching this would think we hadn't arranged it in advance. And the minute I started talking about it, I'm like, I think I've gone, I shouldn't have brought it up because without seeing it, it wouldn't land. You know?
No, I just am that prepared for any circumstance. If you have ALF crap, send it to us at info, or no, I always do this, nick@foundfootagefest.com, or at the address below, you can physically send it to us as well. Next week, episode 11, the Tanners go camping. And this is a weird episode, George. This is a very strange, pretty dark episode.
Yeah, it was the it's the hardest to get through for me.
Thus far. Yeah, you know what? I have an admission too. I watched 3 episodes in a row maybe 2 weeks ago. This was one I fell asleep during. But not because it's boring. I was just tired, but it's a strange episode. So we have a lot to unpack. Join us next week. And thanks for joining us in Willie's garage, everybody. Come crashing with his garage.